Thank you. So the year is 1953, and Mohammed Mossadegh is speaking to Averell Harriman, a US envoy to Iran at the time. The democratically elected leader of Iran says, "You do not know how crafty they are," referring to the British. "You do not know how evil they are. You do not know how they sully everything they touch." Well, what became apparent after that day was, in fact, he knew very well quite how much the British could sully what they were touching in Iran. The coup that took place and the return of the Shah to rule Iran at that point really shaped what we understand to be BP today, because of course Mossadegh wanted to nationalize the Anglo-Iranian oil company, which was the precedent to BP. Now, what I wanted to talk on and touch on in a limited way, definitely, is a point that has been made already, really, the way in which British intelligence and US intelligence, really, at this stage, as we saw with the Iraq War, there was a tug of war and an imposition of will which took place on British foreign policy by US intelligence. And what we are now in a situation is that we are actually vulnerable to the same thing taking place. And of course, there is those contradictions really playing out within those institutions. But the thing that I wanted to deal with is discrediting what is the mainstream elite narrative that is being laid, in the foundation that is being laid to allow that process to take place. So many have tried to say, echoing what Trump put forth, that Iran, quote unquote, was violating the nuclear deal. Well, in fact, if you were to ask the International Atomic Energy Agency, they published more than a dozen reports stating that Iran was fully in compliance with the deal, despite the fact that even in April 2008, you had James Mattis saying the nuclear deal had been pretty robust, and even the head of the Israeli military had said that with all its faults, the nuclear deal was working. Of course, that was simultaneous to Israeli clandestine assassination operations within and outside Iran taking place. We also know that you even had George Bush quoting in his book a national intelligence estimate on Iran that said that, as we judge it with high confidence, that in the fall of 2003, at a time when, of course, Iran's relationship with the United States was not where it is today, with the invasion of Afghanistan and the invasion of Iran, that Iran halted any nuclear weapons programs. Now, this was the national intelligence estimate as quoted by George Bush in his book. This has to be taken seriously, right? So when we're being given this claim that what Iran is doing is producing nuclear weapons, this is quite easily discredited, and we must continue to do that. When we look at the sanctions that have taken place, they are essentially a form of economic war. Dennis Halliday, who was the UN Assistant General and Human Coordinator in Iraq and resigned in protest to the sanctions in 1998, he said the following: "Comprehensive sanctions, when imposed by the UN Security Council or by a state on a sovereign country, are a form of warfare, a blunt weapon that inevitably punishes innocent civilians. If they are deliberately extended when their deadly consequences are known, sanctions can be deemed a form of genocide." Now, what has been the result of these sanctions? According to the IMF, 80% of Iran's oil exports have fallen. Now, that is its main source of income. And it's projected that the economy of Iran will shrink by 6% this year. Now, we also have to see the way, despite the fact that it just being the United States that has pulled out of the nuclear deal, the sanctions affect so many other relations with other countries. So, for example, Taiwan, Greece, Italy have completely halted and that in terms of China, that has reduced by 39%, and in terms of India, the imports of Iranian oil have reduced by 47%. The US government has estimated that Iran's government has lost more than $10 billion in revenue as a result of these changes in the oil industry. Over the last year, we've seen the cost of red meat and poultry increase by 57%. You've seen milk, cheese, and eggs increase by 37%, and vegetables increase by 47% in Iran. Now, in fact, the IMF estimates that in terms of inflation in Iran, it will it's already increased by 31% in 2008, and as of 2019, it will increase by 37%. So, what we're seeing really with this economic warfare is we're seeing a really, really dangerous situation that will undoubtedly have human consequences. Now, Robert Pate, whose studies were actually funded by the Defense Department, looked at 115 cases. Now, within the logic of the Defense Department, those 115 cases of sanctions historically, he found that only 5 out of 115 worked, as far as we're supposed to understand sanctions are meant to work. So Robert Pink asked the question. He said, what could be the reason, if these economic sanctions are not doing what they're proposed to be doing, that decision makers do? So he says, one possibility, decision makers impose sanctions systematically, who impose sanctions systematically overestimate the prospect of coercive success of sanctions. Number two, he said leaders contemplating ultimate resort to force often expect that imposing the sanctions first will enhance the credibility of subsequent military threats. And number three, imposing sanctions usually yields leaders greater domestic political benefits than does refusing calls for sanctions or resorting to force. Now, what we see is the way in which the GDP of Iran in 5 years because of sanctions was slashed by 48%. Now, the population of Iraq is 37 million people. Iran is 83 million people. What we're talking about in terms of human consequences of what is happening will be very, very dangerous in years to come, and it is laying the foundation for the weakening of the state for attack. Now, in terms of British military involvement and the way Britain is being dragged further and further into this real quagmire, we have seen the HMS Montrose and the destroyer HMS Duncan joining two US ships to continue to escort tankers through the Strait of Hormuz. But even if you were to look at it in really crude British interests, crude oil exports to imports to Britain, 50% of them, and 60% of the natural gas actually come from Norway. You know, Britain is reliant on Russia, Sweden, and the Netherlands for petrol. The coal comes from Russia, Colombia, and the US. The electricity that Britain imports comes from France.